Hello and welcome to Capital Conversations. This is NET News weekly discussion with policymakers whose decisions affect Nebraskans' lives. With me today is Senator Laura Ebke of Crete. Thanks very much for coming in.
Thanks for having me.
Could you tell folks, this is your first year in the legislature, a little bit about your background and what you've been doing up until now?
Sure. Well, I grew up in Fairbury and have lived in this part of Nebraska most of my life, except for our school years. My husband is a physician, family physician in Crete, and about 20 years ago, I started getting interested in teaching. I had my bachelor's degree in political science and was working on a master's degree, so I got my master's degree, and then when we moved back to Nebraska after my husband's military time, I went and to the university, got my PhD in political science, and have been teaching on and off as an adjunct in different locations since then. A few years ago, I got re-engaged in political things. You don't become a political scientist unless you're interested in politics. So I got re-engaged in actually being involved in the political process as an activist, and then decided a couple years ago to make this run.
Was there a particular issue that got you re-engaged?
I think as my kids got a little bit older, and I started looking at our national debt. I was very concerned about our national debt. Post 9/11, I saw a lot of the impositions of the federal government in terms of civil liberties. So, kind of a combination of things really got me re-engaged.
And you're down to the nitty-gritty here in the legislature.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
I wanted to ask you about your priority piece of legislation this year. It has to do with the minimum wage. Could you describe a little bit about that?
Sure. LB 599 is a bill that would lower the minimum wage or keep the minimum wage at $8 an hour as it's been amended for youth workers, those who are 18 and under, who are still in school. Really what this is sort of a first job pay. And it was brought to me by the Nebraska Grocers Association. The small town grocers especially are very concerned. A lot of times they only have, you know, three or four people in the store at a time, sometimes only two. And there are limits from a federal standpoint to what those workers under the age of 18 can do. And so what we wanted to do was give small employers especially an incentive to go ahead and hire youth workers, who, even though they couldn't necessarily do everything that an adult worker could do.
Okay. Now, the voters just approved an increase in the minimum wage in stages up to $9, so this would hold that?
It would hold it at the current $8. Mm-hmm. It would go into effect next January, so those hired after that point wouldn't have to be above that if they were, as long as they're still in school. That's the key. They have to still be in school.
K-12,
right. Well, but it could be homeschoolers. It could be, as long as they are still enrolled in school and under the age of 18.
Okay, well, now two questions occur to me about this. One's philosophical and the other's constitutional. Philosophically, if the voters have spoken, are you saying, well, wait a minute, I know better than the voters?
No, I don't think so. I think what we're saying is that maybe we didn't think about these first jobs. It was placed on the ballot, and the argument was we need a living wage, we need a living wage. I get that, but by the same token, most 15 and 16 year olds are still at home. They're talking about spending money. They are in reality not that valuable all the time as employees. I managed in a previous life, I managed a Burger King restaurant, and there were all sorts of things that we couldn't let our younger workers do because of the hazards that are associated with the federal labor law. So they couldn't use certain size knives, they couldn't lift anything above a certain weight, they couldn't use certain machinery in the store. So they have a lesser value. plus a lot of 15 and 16-year-olds, and we were talking a little while ago, we both have 16-year-olds. You know, a lot of 16-year-olds don't understand that it's important to actually get out of bed, to actually show up for work on time, to let your employer know that you're not going to be there.
Our offspring
are accepted, of course, because we'll make sure that they get there, right? But I think it's important for the kids to learn some of those early lessons, and we're allowing small employers. Again, I don't see this applying to many big employers because the market will, especially in large towns, the market will require them to pay that full minimum wage anyhow.
Okay. And the constitutional question is that the Nebraska Constitution says if the voters pass something by initiative, legislature can't amend it without a two-thirds vote.
That's my understanding as well. We think we're pretty close to the votes to get this through.
So it would take 33 votes out of a 49-member legislature.
Right.
Okay. And when is this going to come up for debate?
Well, it's on the agenda, but it keeps getting pushed off of the agenda because of other things. I'd say depending on what the Medicaid expansion debate goes like in the next couple of days, it should be on in the next week or so.
Okay. You're also the treasurer of an organization called the Republican Liberty Caucus.
Right.
What's that, and what's the philosophical approach of that group?
Sure. The Republican Liberty Caucus is a national organization that's really been around since 1991. Here in Nebraska, we chartered back in 2008. And the idea is really to sort of take the Republican Party back to its roots, sort of a traditional conservative, smaller government approach that a lot of times Republicans talk about, but they don't necessarily exercise. So civil liberties, smaller government, we do things a little bit differently. We agree with most of the traditional conservatives on a lot of things, but there are some things where we part ways.
Now, one issue on which you personally parted ways with the Republican Party this year was the winner-take-all electoral vote thing. What was your thinking on that?
Yeah, I think that was more as a political scientist, as one who's studied these things with a fair amount of in-depth thinking. And as I read through the original intent of the founders, as I looked at what happened in the early years of the Constitution, it seemed to me that the founders would have intended for us, or at least expected, that electoral votes would be split in much the way that we've done it. If you look at Nebraska's electoral votes, for instance, you know, it's five total votes based on the number of senators who were supposed to represent the whole state and the number of representatives who were supposed to represent their individual districts. I kind of think that the reason why the Electoral College was set up with those kinds of numbers was that the founders intended or thought, at least, that the states might divide that way as well.
Okay. You mentioned the Medicaid expansion debate, which is about to begin again.
Mm-hmm.
You have not participated in the previous 2 years when there was a filibuster that stopped Medicaid expansion, mm-hmm. so I'm just curious what your view on it is.
Yeah, I'm very skeptical about Medicaid expansion. I understand a lot of the arguments for it, and you know, we've been getting a pile of things to read, of course, from all manner of groups. But my big concern, I didn't mention this earlier, but I served on a school board for 12 years,
and
as as one who served on a school board for 12 years, I've seen many things where both the federal and the state government mandate things for us, and promise payment. But then over time, the payments diminish as the funding changes at another level of government. So whether you're talking about special education or No Child Left Behind, the level of funding doesn't always stay where they promise. And I don't think that a current Congress can commit a future Congress to 90% funding. So, you know, 5 or 6 or 10 years down the line, we may be talking about real big numbers that, you know, we've pushed people into the system, or we've allowed people to get into the system, but then, you know, the funding from elsewhere isn't there, and so then the question becomes, okay, how do we pay for this?
Mm-hmm.
And then it rests with the state then to find that funding.
Okay. Last thing I want to ask you about is what the governor and others identified as the big issue this session, property tax relief. What's your view on what, if anything, is going to happen on that?
I think there's just a lot of things swirling around out there yet. I'm becoming greatly skeptical about whether or not we're going to get anything on property tax relief, although I know that the governor and there's a few senators who are still working really hard to try to attach something, either as an amendment or as a standalone bill. Something may get pulled out of committee. I think we're a couple of weeks down the line on that yet.
Okay, well, we'll watch for that.
Absolutely.
Thanks again for coming in.
Absolutely.
This is Capital Conversations. You can find us on the web at netnebraska.org/news. We'll have another discussion next week and hope to see you then.